the future is going to be dominated by a fusion between Asian culture and predominantly Chinese culture and Western culture, which is predominantly going to be North American culture. Remember that your civilization mostly consists of books, and if you haven't read them, if you haven't read the great books, you're basically a barbarian. If there's one thing I would do differently if I got another chance at being an adult, it would be to spend more time with my children and less time working.
对于世界格局有着深入的研究，在他享有美誉的著作《文明》中，他对比了东西方文明的发展模式，分析了为什么西方文明自以5000年后崛起并征服世界大部分地区的文明，而在今天呢，他认为东方文明蓬勃崛起，世界权力的天平正在转移，西方的主导地位是否将终结于我们这个时代，东西方文明在未来的走向将是怎样，而新的世界秩序又会如何呢？
Empire is about power. Empires arise often spontaneously through investment, through migration, but ultimately they require some element of coercion to qualify as empires. I think the lesson of the late 20th century and the early 21st century is that you can't actually run an empire anymore. It's just too expensive. But I think empire is over. Civilization is completely different. Civilization is not about coercion, it's not about power, it's about influence. And civilizations spread, sometimes in tandem with empire, but not necessarily. And they spread through the processes of social networks. Why does a language become as dominant as Chinese has become in East Asia, as English has become in the Western Hemisphere? It's not just that empire imposed that language, it's more that the language spread naturally through migration, through markets, and through social networks. And history is in many ways a story of some civilizations getting to critical mass and others not making it. And it seems like a reasonable bet that China's civilization will expand. Not necessarily that China's borders will expand, not that China's power will expand, but simply that China's civilization will become more influential, more people will speak the language as a second language, more people will watch Chinese movies than in the past, more people will read books by Chinese authors. And that spread of China's civilization is something which I think is exciting, because part of what I love about the study of civilization is that when civilizations meet, they don't clash. Sam Huntington wrote a book, The Clash of Civilizations, which was a profoundly influential book, but also wrong. Most conflicts are within civilizations. Look at the Islamic world today, where Sunni and Shia are killing one another on a daily basis. That's a clash within a civilization. What's really interesting about civilizations is that when they meet, they more often fuse. And so what I'm really excited about is the Asian fusion civilization of the 21st century, which is kind of Asian and also kind of American and a little bit European. That mixed civilization is part of what makes the 21st century really exciting and fascinating.
And Napoleon said, you know, China is a sleeping giant, right? When he wakes, he's going to shake the world. So as you said, you know, you see this decline of the Western civilization and the rise of the Eastern civilization. How soon do you think this will happen, that the Eastern civilization will rise up?
Well, I think it's important to realize that the Western civilization is not exactly in decline. Western power is in decline. In relative terms, Western economies are in decline. But it's interesting how powerful Western civilization is, even despite the relative decline of Western power. We're having a conversation in a Western language. Britain is no longer a great power. It is no longer an empire. But the language of Shakespeare is amazingly pervasive. the Western way of life, just the way that we organize our days, the way that we dress, the way that we eat, the fact that we go to the gym, all of the stuff that is essentially Western in origin, is now global. What's fascinating is this great Western civilization, which we all almost take for granted, now has some competition from the awakened giant that is China. And China is gradually finding its way to exporting its civilization. And this is happening sometimes in a systematic way with Confucius Institutes around the world, and programs designed to encourage people to learn Chinese. My six-year-old son was absolutely fascinated when he saw a video that Jack Ma produced of his martial arts heroes. That's the spread of civilization that I like, because it's not being forced down anybody's throats. He just thought it was cool. I think what's interesting about China today is the extent to which the system of the People's Republic is selectively picking elements from China's ancient history and adapting them for modern use. So this is a very interesting process of, I'd call it, civilizational rediscovery.
在《文明》一书中，福格森把西方文明崛起的原因归为六个方面：竞争、财产权、科学、医药、消费和工作。在中国崛起的过程中，这六个方面起到了怎样的作用？又对中国的未来之路带来了怎样的启示？
Gao Xiqing had a question that how do you think these six killer apps are going to play out now?
That Western ascendancy was not about culture or race or any of those things. It was about institutions and ideas. And the central argument of civilization was, hey, the rest, beginning in Japan and then in China, have downloaded the killer applications. They basically got the ideas and institutions that worked for Europe and worked for North America, and they've downloaded them.And so, not surprisingly, now that they have the ideas and institutions that work, they're catching up and may even overtake the West.
I think people are even surprised nowadays what China has achieved.
Even after 10 years of economic reform, nobody in the West anticipated a scenario in which China's economy would be larger than that of the United States by the year 2018.And by the purchasing power parity adjusted measure, that is the case today. Nobody expected that China would be able to sustain these rates of growth right the way into the second decade of the 21st century with no real end in sight. The Great Divergence was the story of world history from around the 1500s until the 1970s. A divergence that put the West in charge economically, politically, culturally.In our lifetimes, we've seen the great reconvergence, and it's much faster. It's taking much less time for China to catch up than it took the West to establish a dominating lead. And I think anybody who's trying to call the outcome of modern Chinese history, when the People's Republic hasn't even reached its 100th birthday, is jumping the gun. This is going to take time.
So in the coming, say, 500 years,So dominance of a civilization will look very different from, you know, the past 500 years with the Western civilization dominating the rest of the cultures.
Right. I think that's for sure. The perception of China today is that this is an alternative model and it has strengths compared with an American democracy that looks increasingly dysfunctional. If it turns out that China's system of limited political competition is in fact better at coping with the challenges of the 21st century, better at coping with problems from climate change through to cyber
security,
then maybe more and more countries around the world will say, actually, we're going to choose the Chinese way. The future is going to be dominated by a fusion between Asian culture and predominantly Chinese culture and Western culture, which is predominantly going to be North American culture.
深厚的历史学沉淀，对宏观叙事的把控以及独到的见解，让福格森在中美两国的知识圈中都颇受推崇。从苏格兰的小城少年到全球知名学者，各国政要的座上宾，福格森如何成就自我？请看下节。
福格森呢，涉猎广泛，横跨学术界、政经界和媒体圈，又视野广阔，对国际历史、国际关系和经济史的研究尤其深入独到。他呀是一位笔耕不辍的作家，可以说是著作等身，出版过15本书，好些成为了全球畅销书，5本呢还在美国被拍成了电视剧。究竟他为何既能如此高产，又能兼顾广度与深度？什么样的成长经历使他拥有这些特质与能力呢？
And you research and write on vastly different wide range topics. So how do you become an expert in such different fields?
I'm driven by curiosity, and my curiosity usually leads me down tunnels of reading. But I'm glad to say that I don't just research by reading, though that's definitely the bedrock. I think you also need to do what the great British historian Richard Cobb called research with your feet, travel. You need to go to a different country, see for yourself how it operates. But I'm always led by questions that I want to answer for myself, and I have to confess that every one of my 15 books I really wrote to educate me. It's nice that other people get to read those, and I'm motivated to spread my discoveries. I'm a kind of compulsive autodidact, and no sooner have I finished one book than I have questions that lead me to the next.
But how do you master big topics like, you know, World War I, that you write like a bestseller book in like 5 months?
I took a lot longer than 5 months to write The Pity of War. I mean, most books have a longer genesis than people realize. The writing may take a year or so, but the research takes many years. I don't think mastery is ever actually attainable, and I don't feel as if I've ever mastered any subject. The feeling I get when I publish a book is that it's a kind of compromise between my ambition and my capability. You could never publish because you would never be finished with the research. But I'm prepared to compromise and say, okay, this is the best I can do. It ain't perfect. There are bits missing.
But do you find that, you know, when you communicate with the public as a serious academic and historian, do you have to compromise the truth or make the truth somehow very simple for the public to accept?
It's very important to simplify your arguments. And I always tell my students, before you sit down and write a paper, write an essay, make sure you can summarize your argument in a sentence. Simplification is not misrepresentation. If it's done right, it's simplification. It's putting the ideas clearly as possible, as if you were explaining it to your six-year-old son.
作为一位历史学家，福格森一直致力于寻找事实与真理，从来不畏惧提出与公众常识相反的观点。他为基辛格写的传记就是一个例子。福格森说基辛格是一个理想主义者，这个与主流相反的观点和近年来大热的中美话题让这本书大受关注。虽然他自己也知道成为少数派在这个网络时代有遭遇人身攻击的危险。
Kissinger says, in our modern world of global online networks, there is a kind of anarchy. We should never have expected the creation of enormous online networks to lead to a harmonious, happy, clappy world. We created a world which I think was always going to be more dangerous than we wanted to believe. And the kinds of polarization that I see in modern democracies, not only in the United States, but in many European countries, are quite hard to bring under control. We've created engines of confirmation bias, engines of polarization. They encourage not just fake news, but also extreme views. And this is making it very much harder than it used to be to manage a democratic system, because the center is kind of hollowed out. Moderate opinion doesn't get retweeted. If you base world order on online networks, you will get the very opposite, as I've done all my adult life, to public debate on issues ranging from foreign policy to fiscal policy to social policy. You now run the risk of being attacked by the Twitter mob. And these attacks, when they happen, are extremely, extremely unnerving, to the point that I think many people say, you know what, I'm just going to stay out of this. I'm just going to retreat into the private sphere and not risk the kind of humiliation that is now routinely dished out to anybody who seems to say the wrong thing at the wrong time.
But you are considered a contrarian. Do you, you know, do your views just happen to be contrarian to the mainstream, or do you try to be a contrarian?
I've never set out to be a contrarian just for its own sake. My interest has always been, as an historian, to arrive at the truth. And often the truth turns out to be at odds with what conventionally people think. We need to sit down when we are researching the past, put our preconceptions aside, and try to reimagine the past as it was lived by people at the time, recapture their experience. And very often when I do that, in fact it's been a consistent pattern in my career, I discover that things are quite different from what I've been led to believe, that some historians in the past, for whatever reason, came to the wrong conclusions. We need to have an unrestrained and open debate about historical issues, without political correctness, without the issues of our time being back projected onto the issues and the problems of the past.
福格森自幼沉迷于阅读，十五岁时他读了托翁的《战争与和平》，激发了他对历史的兴趣，改变了他的人生。他最终穷极一生去思考书中提出的关于国家和社会的问题，也因此成为了历史学家。
And your friend Fred Hu had a question that, you know, how do you make leaders from both sides, especially Washington, to be more aware of the stark lessons of history of this competing power conflict?
Well, I think it's true that China's leaders are better at studying history than America's leaders. I shudder to think how few history books Donald Trump has read in his life. Graham Allison and I argued a couple of years ago that what the president needed was a council of historical advisors rather than just economic advisors. China's leaders get that. I always think of how Wang Qishan used to get the members of the Standing Committee of the Politburo to read Tocqueville. I'd love to see just a little bit of the same kind of thing happening in Washington, where American leaders would dedicate time to studying Chinese history. We're not there yet.
How did you develop your love for reading and your reading habits?
I grew up in the west of Scotland in the 1960s and 1970s. There wasn't a lot else to do. It rains a lot in Scotland. The television in those days was pretty poor. And so if I wasn't playing football, I was reading. And I was addicted to reading from a very early age. I still am. A day without reading for me is a ruined, an unsatisfactory day. Everything I've written has been preceded by a really large amount of reading, and the ratio, in my view, should be somewhere between 100 and 1,000 to 1. You should have read 1,000 pages for every one that you write. And if I had my way, that ratio would appear on the cover of every book in a bookstore, and you could tell at a glance which books were properly researched and which were not. And I encourage all my children to read. I wish they would read as much as I did, but they've grown up in a different time with so many distractions. I feel sorry for today's young people, because these dreadful smartphones that we all carry around are a massive distraction from sustained reading.
Anything in your upbringing that helped to, you know, give you the ability to read and write about topics like these?
I think the answer to that is grandfather. My grandfather on my mother's side was a journalist, but he never went to university. He had to start work at the age of 16 in a newspaper office because his family couldn't afford for him to go to university. He was a deeply literate man. He could quote whole passages from Shakespeare. He was a wonderfully talented writer. My grandfather, who made me think that the books were really where I wanted to live. I wanted to live in book-lined rooms where the walls were just books, and my role would be to add my own small contribution to this vast library of books.
And other than the love of reading, what other values do you want to pass your children?
Integrity, honesty. We live in a very strange world. We're surrounded by temptations. We don't have great moral guidelines. Religion is much less important in people's lives than it used to be. I came to the conclusion as an adult that you had to have something more than just science to guide you, that if all you knew was science, you might not necessarily be good. So I've dragged my children along to church periodically so that they get some sense of the ethical framework. I would say that's my message to my kids. read, remember that your civilization mostly consists of books. And if you haven't read them, if you haven't read the great books, you're basically a barbarian. But when you're reading, as you're accumulating knowledge, remember the importance of a moral framework. The ability to choose between good and evil, or between the greater and lesser evil, is the most important ability that a human being can develop. And I think the key to parenthood is to communicate to your children as quickly as you can the ability to make those choices. Because as soon as they're teenagers, they're going to be confronted with choices between good and evil.
And in the VUCA world nowadays, the values that keep them grounded becomes ever more important.
Right. And I do think that in the age of information overload, when there's simply an impossibly large amount of stuff coming at you, it's more important than ever to have a moral framework.
Mm. Has your professional success ever cost you something?
Oh, the most important problem of whatever success I've had has been the time that it has taken away from my children. If there's one thing I would do differently if I got another chance at being an adult, it would be to spend more time with my children and less time working.
But if you have done that, would you have reached the same level that you're at now?
Perhaps not, but I'd have been a better father.
我在今天见到福格森教授的时候啊，他基本上已经在路上跑了有半年的时间，去到全世界各个国家去进行巡回的演讲和新书的推销。那他说，在过去的25年里，他出版了15本书。那每一次出书，其实都要经历这样的一个过程。那他在跟我聊天的时候就坦言说，他为成功付出的最大的代价就是他的家庭。那他这个工作狂的特质呢，已经导致了他的一次离婚和对前三个小朋友的成长感到非常的愧疚。那他今年的目标啊，也就是要学会说不，要把更多的时间可以留给家庭。但另一方面，我又看到其实对他来说啊，要做到这样的一个慢下来的事情其实非常的困难，因为他是好奇心驱使，他在每做一本书的这个研究写作过程中就已经会想到下一本书的一个话题，因为他所有的书都是为自己而写，为他的好奇心，为了他学习的欲望而去写作。所以对于他这样的人来说，其实要达成工作和家庭间的平衡是非常困难的。但起码他的一个人生感悟的分享就是，他情愿在事业上退后几步，都要把这个人生的重心重新要放回到家庭。
帕特基辛格是全球最受瞩目的职业经理人之一，他带领最顶尖的软件公司 VMware 微瑞起死回生，也曾经是英特尔的首席技术官。他是个工作狂，但他更是个好丈夫、好爸爸。下集让我们一起来听听他是如何平衡生活与事业，努力工作和学会拒绝，怎样才能不矛盾。
接着为您播出《雅居乐地产筑梦天下》。